So, today we'll talk about class two malocclusion in the permanent dentition. So, just to define orthodontics, it's when we want to move teeth and the alveolar process. And orthopedics, an orthopedics alteration involves skeletal, neuromuscular, and connective and epithelial alteration. And we know three types of orthopedics. The natural orthopedics, that is the growth induced, that is the correction during early treatment, and the surgical. And so this is orthodontics, it's alveolar bone. So to me, it's a lot. We can affect all this area in the maxilla and also in the mandible. And as you can see here from Ricketts, this is a patient with a full denture. So there is no teeth, no alveolar bone. So by definition, the alveolar bone is the bone that supports the teeth. So with orthodontics, we can affect this bone and we can move the teeth through the alveolar bone. So to me, orthodontics is really, really a lot. And to me, the bioprogressive science defined by Ricketts gives to me all the answers in the orthodontic field. And the bioprogressive science is not a technique, but is a combination of the various modalities used in a logic sequence. Always, everybody, we use edgewise, that means bracket plus rectangular wire. But the focus is not the type of bracket employed, but how it is being used, where it is applied, or what is to precede it, and the difference in objectives deemed possible. So, in orthodontics, dealing with the biologic variation, are a few laws that can be applied. The bioprogressive approach is characterized by application of principles. And a principle is a general truth that is most often trustworthy, but not without exception. And so these are the 30 principles that Ricketts listed back in the 60s. And I'll try to get some of this principle during my lecture. And I want to start with the principles number one. It is very important. It's love your patient, follow the truth, and maintain peace. This is very, very important, especially in this period. So when we go to work, we are happy to go to work, and we are very happy to give this service for our patients. And when we say class two, to me, you don't mean nothing, because the class two, our angle, classified more than 100 years ago, is distal occlusion, because he was taught and he was convinced that the problem was in the mandible and not in the maxilla. So when he classified this, he thought that the maxilla was fixed in the cranium, and the upper first molar was fixed under the key ridge, under the jugal process, that he called key ridge. And he called key ridge for this reason, because key is the reference. And so he start to correct class two, moved the mandible forward. And the class three was major occlusion, because the problem for Engel was in the mandible. So he treated the mandible, pushed mandible back. And Ricketts said, no, we must start the classification from the lower molar, not from the upper molar. And why? Because he did a lot of research. Let's say this. And this is not one subject. Here we can see a composite of 40 subjects. Okay, this is not a safe of the 40 subject at the age of 8 in class 1. And when we compare with the 34 subject in class 2, high convexity at the same age, we superimpose, okay, you can see in superimposition 1 that the main difference is in the maxilla, is not in the mandible. And look here how the maxilla is forward. The mandible is the same, it's very similar. The cranial base is bigger in class 2. And we listed, this Ricketts listed these characteristics of class 2 that he called the 10 components of class 2. So the posterior cranial base is longer, the anterior cranial base is longer in class 2, the chin is backward in class 2, but the mandible, if you look at the mandible is longer, but it's bended backward. But the upper jaw position, as you can see here, it's the main difference. And the upper incisors are more protruded. Here, you can see here. And the lower incisors are more retruded. The lower molars are more distal, but we add two other characteristics. And this is by Sato. I learned this by Sato. Ricketts he defined, but he didn't list it. And I add this, the upper molars are less erupted in class two. So we have a steeper occlusal plane. And the lower molars are more erupted in class two. And here, if you work, if you see this work published in the American Journal by Sato, you can see when you compare class two, class one, and when you compare class one, class two, and class three, you can see here, this is class one, it's normal, but in class two, look that the occlusal plane is steeper. Look, because the upper molar is less erupted and the lower molar is more erupted. In the class three, it's the opposite. The upper molar is more erupted and the lower molar is less erupted. So you have a different inclination of the occlusal plane during, this is during the growth. This is normal, this is class three, and this is class two. There is a very, very big difference. And this in turn affect all the cranial bones. And so you can do a very great job if you focus your treatment in the occlusal plane, the position of the occlusal plane, and during the correction in class two, maintain the occlusal plane flat. Don't use mechanics that push the lower molar upward, because that one will in turn make the mandible rotated backward. A posterior rotation of the mandible will cause a posterior rotation of the mandible. Okay, so unlock the malocclusion in the keep unlocked. It is the principle number 8 that we use during the class 2 correction. Okay, this is the evidence-based class 2 therapy. Maintain always the occlusal plane here downward, and so use all the mechanics that push the the lower molar downward. So a little extrusion, little by little, of the upper molar will help you during class two correction. Okay, don't use mechanics that allow the lower molar erupted more. And this is published in literature. Ricketts was the first that published this back in the 60s in the angular orthodontist. Then Baumrind confirmed these findings from Ricketts, Cook, Terry Selke from Illinois, then Loberg, and many others. And here, Alagabakis, Gott, Leon and Franchi from Italy too. And here, my friends, Opperman, Enrique Garcia, Buticus Noto, and Blago Fanches, that they compare eyepool Edgar with the cervical Edgar, okay, in class two. And they show that the cervical Edgar show more favorable changes in mandibular growth that were statistically significant when compared with controls. So the cervical Edgar showed a more control over the vertical dimension that produced more favorable change in mandibular position by normalizing occlusal plane. This is amazing. And this is me with the group in the University of in Subria. We found in the sample that I used during my PhD thesis the same conclusion. The vertical dimension was not significantly altered after cervical Edgar treatment. There was a significant counterclockwise rotation of the mandible in patients with the open bite with the increased vertical dimension treated by cervical Edgar. And this is really amazing. Again, this is with the group of Messina and in Subria, a university where I teach. We found the same thing in the same group, but we focus in occlusal plane. And we found the same finding, same thing. And look, this is from my PhD thesis. Look how the extrusion that there is during the correction, but this extrusion is compensated by the vertical growth of the ramus. And look, the intrusion of the lower molar and the control that we have during the class two correction, applying these principles during the early treatment. And this is from Ricketts, and Bjork confirmed the findings that Ricketts finding back in the 1952 here, that he published in the American Journal with the ones that Bjork published 17 years later. When the condyle grows here, upward and forward, the chin will grow forward. When the condyle grows upward and backward, the chin will grow backward. But look the occlusal plane, look the occlusion. This is a flat, you will have a class three on a very, very big chin. But when the occlusal plane is a stupid like here, that indicates to you sobra eruption of the lower molars, you will have a postural rotation of the mandible, a clockwise rotation of the mandible. Okay, and this theory that we applied in class two correction, in the early treatment, in the permanent addition too, because we can affect the joint during the correction, is the decompression theory. And we must respect this area where the mandible grows. So push the upper molar downward. We decompress this area and we allow the mandible to give the potential growth that the mandible have. And this is from Salvatore Boccheri, that is One of the best students that I have now is at the University of in Subria, and he prepared this in order to explain this theory. So we extrude a little bit the upper molar, then we correct orthopedically the class two by correction of the upper jaw. Then there is a vertical growth of the ramus as a response, and we must prevent the interferences in the anterior teeth, in the incisors especially. This is the vertical growth of the ramus, and the condyle start to grow upward and forward, and the chin start to grow downward and forward. This is the best approach that you must have in class two during the growth. But the same principle, I know that the presentation is about permanent dentition, but we apply the same principles, same thing, because you must know the biology in order to treat all the malocclusion and all the patients. Okay, so visualize your objective. So push backward and downward the maxilla, lower the occlusal plane, promote the vertical growth of the ramus, so the mandible can adapt forward, okay? And so proceed in stages. Major objective must be solved first in this way. Secondary objectives will become easier. Therefore, staging approach is more biologic than a fixed tie-up with straight wire. What is the staging methods? Ricketts listed in 1964 is this. So you have not a sequence of wires, but the sequence, a logical sequence of the approach that you have in the malocclusion. So the starting procedures carry out the regulation of the arches, the integration of torque, and the coordination, then the finishing. So if you have no intra-arch regulation, no inter-arch regulation, you can start with the straight wire, okay? This is a lot of occlusion you can treat, and you can start from step five. But if you have a major problem, you start from here, okay? And then little by little with the logical sequence, do all the stages that I show you with my cases. So difference with the straight wire instead of alignment are orthopedic first, then arch length control in the lower jaw, deep bite correction by anterior intrusion, and positioning of the arches based on skeletal relation that the dental plane, APO. And so most of malocclusion are here in the middle. No? You must to standardize most of your treatment in order to individualize the treatment for the patient. Okay? So three key concepts in today's world. This is by Gugino. Individualization, that is the ability to adapt to the needs or special circumstances of an individual, or the basic difference between individuals. Prevention is the action of stopping something from happening or arise, one of the key concepts in today's healthcare. And, sorry. Okay. Simplicity is a thing that is plain, natural, or easy to understand. Technology information overload demands this today. Simplicity is the ultimate sophistication, therefore difficult to achieve. Simplicity requires system. Keep things simple through systems. It's very, very difficult. And many patients start to treat simplicistic, that they making something complicated seem simple by ignoring important part of it. And to me, some approaches today, in these days, are really simplistic. This is simplistic. It looks like very smart, but it's difficult to easy to use. This is really simple. Everybody, we have this kind of technology because it's very, very simple. Okay, I prepared these lectures back in May during the lockdown. So I didn't change the date because remember to me a special day here in Italy when we start we pace in a phase that we start to go to the office and to treat patients, so forth, so on. So to me, this is a very, very special day. So imagine that that day in the office, we are this schedule with this patient. So we have 9 patients, and we want to, here in Sicily, we have usually dinner about 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock in the night, p.m. So we want to arrive on time for dinner. Okay, let's say come in to the first patient, that is Anna. And Anna is class 2. Wait, I want to... Wait a minute, I want to hide. No. Okay, it's too difficult. Okay, don't worry, Sergio. Okay. Anna, she is 10 years old. And these are the model. She has no grouting in the upper and the lower jaw, as you can see here. We are waiting for canines in the upper jaw for premolars. She is very, very symmetrical. And she is brachyfacial. So she has a brachyfacial tendency. She has no orthopedic problem. She has very good convexity, that is here too. Okay, she has a lower incisors retrusion, and she has a severe deep bite, as you can see. But she is class 2, but she has a very, very good mandible. Okay, we don't want to affect this mandible because she is very good. And she complained kind of smile and misalignment in the upper arch. But she has class 2, division 2, deep bite, mesiofascial with the brachyfacial tendency, lower arch retrusion, lower fascial aid reduction. This is in green, you can see the long-term forecast of growth. Okay, we used to predict the growth. In red, there is our treatment, our objective, the VTO. So we can superimpose the red on the green, and you can see the mechanics. So we want to maintain the upper molar here in the same position. We want to give torque and intrusion to the upper teeth, upper incisors, and we want to move forward the lower denture by intrusion of incisors. And so we want to expand the lower arch, okay? And so in this curve, we can put Anna here in the middle, because she is an easy case to us. So we want to move the lower denture forward by mandibular posturing. So, and we do this, this is a simple to me, very, very simple approach. With six brackets in the four bands and two pieces of wire, I correct the malocclusion because I transform a class two division two in a beautiful class one. So after 1 year, I have now all the permanent teeth. I have a lot of space here. I can move now the lower denture forward. And this is to me the best approach that you can have. Here we finish the case with really very beautiful occlusion and a very beautiful bite. You can see the model, the panoral, very symmetrical. And look, the profile is nice. Now the lower denture is positioned one to the apogonium, so it's great. The lip are inside of the aesthetic line. And this is the superimposition analysis. Look, the intrusion that we have and the torque that we have in the upper incisors. And we correct the malocclusion because the mandible grows forward, not for other kind of correction. But the principle, remember, to unlock the malocclusion was to open the bite. Open the bite, unlock the malocclusion means that the mandible can grow forward without anything. So 1 year of utility arch, then we wait 2 years, and then we have the bioprogressive multi-blanket approach to detail occlusion for another 2 years, so another year. So we have 2 years of active treatment. This is before and after. Before and after. Before and after. And this is after 6 years, 9 months. It's a very, very nice occlusion and stable. And now we have Luca. And Luca, he has class two, division two, a full class two, both sides, very, very deep bite, crowding. And I say severe crowding in the lower arch, 10 millimeters of crowding, and also in the upper arch, 10 millimeters. Look the position of the upper incisors, typical of class two, division two, deep bite. And here there is the panoral. And look at the bad position of canines here. And we perform back in 2004 with Bacchetti and Franchi a formula in order to recognize this case and to predict the impaction of upper canine in the posterior-anterior cephalogram. So if you apply this formula, and it's very, very simple because you measure J point from the midline and the distance of from the crown of the upper canine to the midline, and you combine these numbers, you have numbers that is minus 3, that means that this canine will go in the palate. Okay, and so we now we want to publish another paper. We have data, we collect data, and we must to read very carefully this data, but the impression is if you open the anterior part of the maxilla, you will prevent at the age of 8 or 9 the canine impaction. And this is really, really early treatment, not like 11, like Erickson and Kurol and many, many others too. But at the age of 8, it's very, sounds like something of early treatment. And so you can see that instead this canine is well positioned, okay? And in the posterior anterior, it's very, very nice to detect this aspect of the canine eruption. Okay, this is the lateral Ceph, and you can see the same pattern of Anna, but he has a severe lower facial hair reduction and a severe deep bite, okay, with the impressive reduction of the position of the lower incisors. So he complains the misalignment, and the parents say he can see lower incisors. So he has class 2 division, deep bite, brachyfacial, lower arch retrusion, and lower facial eight reduction. It's very similar to one. This is the long range forecast in green, in red is VTO. Okay, so you superimpose, and you can see that we want to distalize a little bit the upper molar, torque to the upper incisors, intrusion, and we want to move forward the lower incisors. Okay, look here, we want to distalize more in the right side and less in the left side. Look the movement of the lower arch in order to correct the class 2. So we put here Luca. Mm. And this is the progressor after 1 year, 7 months. And in order to push the lower denture forward, we applied the elastics in the utility arch. Oh, sorry. And I love these mechanics because I wait for the permanent dentition. And the one, when the permanent teeth came, it's very, very, very easy to detail the occlusion. Very, very easy. Mm. This is when we finish the model, the panoral. Okay. This is the frontal head fin, the lateral, and the lower incisors is still a little bit backward, incredible. Mm. We moved a lot forward, but it's a minus one, the relationship with the dental plane, as you can see here. And he is class two, but he has a concave profile because he has a very, very big chin. This is a class two, but look this mandible, how big it is, how square it is. Mm? Okay, for this reason, to me, class two doesn't mean nothing. Mm? Just a relationship between teeth, but I'll show you different pattern and so different approach that you must have in class two. And this is the superimposition analysis. Look how we correct the class two, because the mandible grows forward, mm? But not for elastics, just for because we unlock the malocclusion, because we intrude the upper incisors, then intrude the lower incisors a lot. We torque the upper incisors, and so we allow in this particular case, because he is a brachyfacial, okay? So the mandible growth, even if you push everything in the mouth, but you must to unlock the malocclusion to have this result without any other appliances. And I love to work together with the growth. That is very, very important. Work together with the growth, applying the biological principles. Mm? So I will call this intermediate treatment, quad helix 1 year, utility arch with elastics 10 months, then we're waiting 1 year, and 1 year to detail occlusion. So active treatment was 2 years and 10 months. This is after 1 year and 8 months. It's a stable case. Look the bite. And this is after 3 years and 6 months. Very, very stable. Mm. I love this result. This is before and after, before and after, before and after. This is the sequence. During the correction with the utility arch and elastics, and then when we finish. Okay, next patient, it's Antonella. Antonella is a class 2, bilateral class 2, with very symmetrical, with all the teeth. Look the symmetry. And the pattern is mesiofacial and very, very nice convexity, because she has a big nose here. But again, the lower incisors is a little bit retruded, and she has a deep bite. Look the class 2. Okay. And a little bit of crowding in the lower arch, 6 millimeter, and 3 millimeter and 4 in the upper arch. And she complained misalignment of upper incisors and the upper lip aversion. And she has a class 2 division 2, deep bite, mesiofacial, and the lower arch retrusion. And the computer suggests, in order to correct the class 2 extraction of the upper premolars. This is the prediction, the outcome of the treatment with the extraction. So I have to have a class 2 relationship and a class 1 in the canine, in order to do not distalize the upper molars. Mm? But we don't like this approach. We want to distalize the upper. We don't to remove the premolars to correct the class 2. We want to distalize in the way that now I show you. So we put Antonella here because it's a very common case of class 2 correction. Okay, so we want to open the bite first. Look, we are still in class 2 in order to unlock the malocclusion. And now we can start in the logical sequence, the inter-arch correction, okay? And so we remove the upper utility arch, and now we start with the section mechanics. We don't want to move all the upper denture backward. It's too difficult. You stress the anchorage. You need pads, mini screw. You need all these things that I don't like because This method is very, very simple. You apply just, a bracket here in the canine, a piece of wire. Okay, this is section mechanics and elastics, elastic, and maximum anchorage in the lower arch. Okay, and then you start in a very, very simple way to correct the class two malocclusion. And in order to select the right elastics in all the malocclusion with the groups of Messina, with the Professor Cicciu, Dr. Fiorillo, Professor Cervino, and Dr. Boccheri, and me, we invented this elastic selector. Okay. We patent this and we publish in MDPI in order to explain how to use this, but it's very, very easy. If you apply and you put this elastic selector, you can choose very, very easily the size of the elastics. We are still during the class two correction. And then we want to give some torque to the upper incisors with this light intruder retractor. And now in the our sequence, in the staging matrix, we want to coordinate. We want to integrate the arches, okay? Because we are here, we have a section here, section the lower. Now we want to connect here, we want to connect not with a straight wire, but with a loop here in order to maintain the open, the bite open. And we use, we usually use, I'll show you the double delta. Now we finished. Okay. And during the correction, you can see that we maintain the wisdom teeth. Because there is no problem, okay? You can push all the dental with this method. Because we forecast that the lower molars will be erupted a little bit more, but we extract it later. But it's just to show you that you can do. You can move all the upper denture backward with these section mechanics. It's very, very impressive. Okay, this is the lateral. Beautiful result, beautiful position of the lower incisors. We didn't affect the rotation of the mandible. She was symmetrical, and she is symmetrical. And look here, the correction that we have, the distalization, the position of the mandible, the intrusion that we have in the lower arch. And this is the result after 2 years, very stable, very, very nice occlusion. And this is after 9 years and 5 months, very, very stable result. The bite is really, really open. And this is after 10 years. So long-term result, very, very, very stable. We are proud of this result. Before and after. Okay, the other patient. Is Damiano. Damiano, he has a full class two in the right side and a class two in the left side. Deep bite, fracture of incisors, upper incisors, and he hasn't crowding. Not in the lower and not in the upper arch. And this is the parol. He has the wisdom teeth. Okay. And this is the frontal Edwin, he is a little bit, asymmetrical. He has in the right side, the ramus, it's a little bit shorter. And you can see that the mandible, it's very square. And he has a lower facial height reduction, but he has a 60 of convexity. And you can see the classical class two profile with the upper lip that is more protruded than the lower lip. So we call this upper lip aversion, like the other patient. Look the deep bite. Look where he bite here. Mm? And so he complained the fracture of the upper incisors, the misalignment in the upper arch. He is a class two, deep bite, mesiofacial brachyfacial tendency, lower arch retrusion, and lower facial height reduction. He has a little bit of growth because he was 17. Males grows until 19 years old. And you can see here the correction that we want to do with Damian. So when you superimpose the VTO, the long range forecast, you can see the mechanics. So we want to push a little bit the lower denture forward. We want to intrude the lower incisors. We want to intrude the upper incisors, torque the upper incisors, and distalize the upper arch. And so we put Damiano here. He's a classical class two correction, and we call this reciprocal because we want to move the lower denture forward, but we want to distalize the upper denture too with the sexual mechanics. And so we did this. Look the space, the amount of space that we have with this fantastic approach, this amazing approach. Look how space, how much space we have. And we used to start from the second lower molar in order to have a very horizontal component with the elastic traction. This is a very, very, very nice correction, a very nice approach, because we eliminate a lot the vertical component of the elastic by the use of the cortical anchorage in the lower arch with the utility arch, okay? And I want to explain you this mechanics. So we want to put the maximum anchorage, the second molar, then we want to stabilize the anchorage, engage the first molar with the section. Then we start to bund the upper arch, canine and molar. And we put this section that is a little bit longer. So we have a mesial force that tends to mesialize the canine. And we have a distal force that tends to distalize the molar. But if we apply an elastics, we prevent the mesialization of the canine. And so this force goes to the molar. And so we can correct in this way the position of the molar, and we can correct the class two. This is the approach. This is the sectional mechanics. Look the space that we have. Then we can close this space with a straight section and with a power thread or with the elastics, simple. And then now we can manage the upper arch with the lower, with the upper, with the light intruder retractor. Okay. then we start to approach in the lower arch. We don't use any bracket here in this space during the correction of class two brackets in the premolar, because we don't want to attach, because you have the cusp here. We wait for class one. Then when we are in class one, we start to bracket the lower arch. Then we want to intrude the canine with a power thread in the utility arch. And now we can put brackets, the straight section, and then we connect with the straight wire or with the double delta, and we can over treat with the elastic the malocclusion. This is Damiano after the correction, beautiful class one. Okay, nice result in the panorama. A little bit still asymmetric here in the ramus of the mandible. Okay, but look the profile that is now it's improved a lot. Look the bite, now it's great. And this is the superimposition analysis. Mm-hmm. Look how the lower incisors went forward, the intrusion, the torque in the upper arch, mm-hmm, and the extrusion of the upper molar. So we have for 1 year the correction with the utility arch and the sectional mechanics, and then we have the biprogressive multiplexing approach for 2 years. So 2 years and 11 months. This is after 3 years, 2 months of treatment. So it's stable. This is before and after. Before and after. Okay. Here there is Marta. Come in, Marta. Marta has a TMJ problem. Mm-hmm. And sorry. And but she is a very simple malocclusion. Now here is in class one, class two, here a little bit of midline deviation and the perio problem on the upper central incisors, crowding on the lower arch, a little bit of crowding in the upper arch. But in the left side of the joint, she has pain and click. Mm. And she has a lock in the left side of the joint, not click, she has a lock. Mm. And she is mesiofascial, brachiofascial tendency. She has a good position of the lower incisors, beautiful convexity with this big nose. So she is well proportioned. Mm. She's beautiful, nice, very nice girl. But here you can see the compression on the right side. So on the healthy side, we have a compression. So she has a lock on the left and a compression on the healthy side. And as you can see the wisdom teeth here in a bad position, all the other teeth, no grounding, very, very small grounding. And look in the right side, the compression and the distal compression on the left side. And look that good movement on the right, but here we have a lock of the joint in the left side, in the other side. So she complained about the pain and the limitation to open the mouth. She has a wisdom teeth impacted, distal displacement and lock on the left joint, superior displacement on the right joint, mandibular symmetry, class 2 on the right, and the periprobium on the upper central incisors in the right side. And also in green, the amount of the growth that we have in this patient. In red, you can see the objective. And she need some intrusion here, and in the upper and in the lower, and some amount of distalization in the upper arch. And for this reason, for the TMJ problem, we put Marta here as a difficult case. Because not always, not every day happens to treat a case like this with the lock. Okay, and so we want to correct with the maximum anchorage in the lower arch. We don't move the lower arch forward. We just move the upper arch backward. So this is maximum anchorage. B means below in the mandible, and sectional mechanics in the upper arch. And in order to unlock the malocclusion and to unlock the joint, in cases like this, we use the biotemplate that is fixed. She can remove. Okay, she hit, she slipped, she make love with this, everything with the biotemplate. Okay, she can't remove. And then we remove just in the office. Okay, so we remove in order to check the new position of the mandible that the function gives to the mandible. And so we saw the interferences was here. Look, in the central where there is the perioprobe, incredible. Okay? So now we start to treat the patient. And we have more options. Okay, we can extrude the teeth here. We can grinding here the upper incisors, or we can use the bioprogressive approach with just an utility arch in this tooth in order to intrude, to remove the interferences, and then the mandible can adapt forward without any interferences. And then we finish. We just want to align now the teeth. But in two months, a difficult case, this is simple. This is the maximum of sophistication that make things simple, things that are difficult, because it was a difficult case for the TMJ problem, but this kind of approach to me, it's very simple, because I transform a very bad malocclusion in a very, very simple malocclusion. And this kind of approach is biological and can permit to reach this kind of result. So we start to little bit of class 2 correction in mandible posturing with the sectional mechanics utility arch in the lower. Okay, and then look at the double delta that we used to connect the section with the anterior part. Okay, now we have a good position of the joint. Look here when she opened the mouth in the left joint. Now it's symmetrical with the right joint. It's a very, very nice result. Okay, And after 1 year and 9 months, we finish. She is beautiful, beautiful smile, full smile. Mm. This is the result on the self. Very symmetrical now. Look, the ramus, we affect the mandible because there was a little bit of growth. Mm. Okay, the panoral, the occlusion, before and after, she has a little bit of lower lip aversion like class 3 case, but she has a big nose, so to me she has a very, very nice profile. Mm. Look, before and after, look the mandible here and look the mandible now. Mm. So we affect, we decompress the condyle with this kind of mechanics, with a little bit of extrusion of the upper molar, okay? And we prevent the extrusion of the lower molar with the maximum anchorage before and after. And look the superimposition analysis, when there was a little bit of distalization here and a little bit of mandibular reposturing and the intrusion and torque before and after the sequence with the biotemplate. Look, the correction mainly was reached by mandibular posturing after we remove the interferences, okay, in the upper arch, the utility arch, and then we finish the case. Very nice. This is after 3 years, very stable case. Beautiful smile, and if you look, we in all the case we like and we love to put the upper premolar, not behind the canine, but upper premolar is buccal to the canine. So the Rieke's prescription is characterized with a raised bracket in the canine, a very thin bracket in the premolars, in order to have this full smile without the black corridor here. And this is another factor of stability and aesthetics that Ricketts suggests and find in the normal occlusion untreated. And we also publish, because this is anatomical characteristic of the human occlusion. We published a couple of years ago with the Messina group, with Professor Cicciu and others. Okay, now there is Davide. We are on time. Davide has class 2 malocclusion subdivision. It means in one side, just in the right side. Mm? Obviously, he has a midline deviation. Okay, no crowding, very beautiful lower arch, beautiful position of the teeth. We don't like this wisdom teeth, particularly this position is unfavorable to eruption, and it's against the second molar, and also this. And he's a little bit asymmetrical, Davide. This is the Ceph. He's mesiofacial with the good position of the lower incisors. She has just a class 2 division, a class 2 subdivision, and a deep bite. Mm-hmm. So he complained deep bite, a different height of the upper incisors. He has an impacted wisdom teeth on the right side is the mesiofascial class 2 subdivision deep bite. He is still growing, so we predict a little bit of growth, and we forecast also the planning. So we superimpose, and now we can see the mechanics. We want to distalize the upper molar, but on one side. The right side more, a little bit on the left side, look this beautiful lower arch, and intrude and torque of the upper incisors. So we want to put Davide here. It's a very easy case. So we open the bite. We obtain the maximum anchorage in the lower arch. And now we are ready to start the correction just on the right side with this kind of mechanics. So we don't want to put bracket on the left side because we don't need. Here we have a beautiful class one. So we don't want to modify this class one. We want to just to correct here. So after we open the bite, we correct the right side, okay, with the sectional mechanics. And then we start the approach in the lower arch. We start to bracket the lower arch. And so this is in the scheme in order that I want to explain the approach in the asymmetrical case. So utility section where you want to correct, let's say the right side, in the left side, a straight section to lock, okay, the canine, and check the torque. Check the torque. You cannot correct if the torque of the canine is like this, if you have a buccal torque. You need to avoid the cortical bone in order to have the class two correction. Then when you move the canine backward, you have various options with the double delta, okay, with elastics. You can activate the double delta on one side. If you have a class three correction, you can put a class three elastic on the other side, and you activated the delta, and you can correct the midline. Or you can use the push and pull utility arch. It is like this. You can push on one side, that is this side, and you pull on the other side. Okay, little by little, with elastics, little by little, and you can correct the, and this is what we did with David. After 2 years, okay, then we finish. After 3 years and 3 months, okay, beautiful denture, beautiful position of the incisors, both upper, lower, and is still asymmetrical a little bit. Before and after. This is before and after of the frontal. So we distalize a little bit the upper molar, and we torqued the upper incisor. This is normal eruption. This is not extrusion because the patient is still growing, okay? But in this case, we had a little bit of rotation of the mandible. That is not good, is not favorable in a class two correction. Some reason, the mandible went a little bit forward, backward in this case. And in class two correction, this unfavorable, it's not favorable. So it's a good case, very nice. But if you do superimposition analysis, you can learn a lot from patient. This is before and after, before and after. Look the bite, look the midline, look the how beautiful is the arch. And this is after 3 years and 6 months. This is after 4 years and 5 months. This is after 5 years and 8 months. Then we remove the lower retainer. And now we can call Alessandro. Alessandro is class two, open bite. Full class two on left side, obviously midline deviation, no crowding. And Alessandro is a very, very clever guy. And he was treated many, many times from other colleagues. And he was referred by a very, very good orthodontist that is a friend of mine. Because in that period, I start to approach this kind of cases with open bite, with the subtle mechanics. So specifically for this reason. And he came with these appliances that I remove. And he came with this kind of asymmetry, with the compression of the ramus in the right side of the mandible. And he has a dolichofacial tendency. Big nose, very nice profile. Eye convexity and good position of lower arch. And he complained that he cannot bite the deviation, and he just doesn't want E8 surgery. So he said, I want to fix my teeth without surgery. Is mesiofacial, class 2, division 1, a severe asymmetry. And another guys tried to treat him, trim the cusps of the molar in order to close the bite. Crazy, crazy approach to me. This is the VTO that we performed on Alessandro with the growth, and this is the plan. So we superimpose. So we want to deslice on one side more, on the other side, and we want to lose anchorage a little bit in the lower arch in order to correct the class two. So for this reason, we want to put Alessandro here. It's not easy, but not very difficult, but not very easy. So we start to expand a little bit the upper arch. In this case, we put the quadilix that we usually use in the first upper molar. We put the quadilix in the second upper molar. And look, we correct the class two and the bite spontaneously, just with the quadilix and the straight wire in the lower arch. Look the correction, the amount of the correction that we obtained just with this approach. To me, this is simple, really simple. Then I start to correct the class two. This is the Sato approach. Okay, and then I check, and you can see that now it's a little bit more symmetrical, but it is still asymmetrical. And I want to check the vertical growth of the ramus in the right side, because here I start to intrude the molar, but extrude the premolar in order to decompress the condyle and permit to the mandible to rotate it forward in that side. This control. This after 2 years, classical SATO approach with the extrusion here in the of the premolars. Okay, this kind of elastic is in order to maintain the bite closed. Okay, this is the result when I remove the appliances. I was very, very happy when I remove the appliances. Alessandro too, he was happy too. And look, you can see in the panoral that the mandible now it's pretty good, incredible result. And look, he is still asymmetrical, okay? The compression there is in the right side. But I improved his function and his aesthetics a lot, I think. Beautiful result. Look the amount of distalization. This is the eruption of the molar. And this is the rotation of the mandible that I obtained with this kind of mechanics. Incredible. In the permanent dentition, during the growth. This is after 1 year and 6 months. I cannot say that it's stable, okay? You can see here that we can prove the intercuspidation, but I already told you, some guys trimmed this cusp in order to close the bite. Crazy, but the bite is still closed. Before and after. Look here. Look the amount of the growth of the ramus and how the symmetry improved. Okay. Now Chiara. Chiara, she has class 3 here and class 2 on the other side, but she has a very, very big overjet because she missed a lower incisors. For this reason, she has this big overjet. And she is a little bit asymmetrical. Obviously, she has a midline deviation. Look the protrusion that she has and the big overjet that she has. She is dolichofacial. The mandible is rotated backward a lot. She is 79 of the fascial axis. She has a very high lower fascial 8, increased the lower fascial 8. She has not crowding. Beautiful upper arch and lower arch, sorry. And so she complained about the overjet, about the protrusion, the excessive protrusion. So she is class 2, division 1, open bite, dolichofacial, overjet increased, lower arch protrusion, and high convexity. And this is the plan. So we want to correct by distalization of the upper arch. But in order to obtain a class 1, if you do this, if you apply this kind of plan that the computer suggests to me, you will reach a class 3 in order to have a beautiful overbite and overjet. And in this case, because I don't treat patient with crowding by extraction of a lower incisors. Okay, I can explain another in another lecture. But in this case, I used to treat with this the treatment that I'll show you. For this reason, I put Chiara here because she's dolichofacial, but she isn't an easy case. So in the case that you have, when someone extract a lower incisors, what happens is that the lower arch tends is very, very narrow and tapered, but if you extract the lower incisors, the arch tends to be more narrow tapered, okay? More and more. Mm? And so in this case, we want instead to expand the arch, okay? And we want to mesialize all the teeth of one hemi arch. And she was in this situation because she has a very, very nice arch. And so in this way, we want to transform the canine in a lower incisors. Then we want to fit in a class one relationship with the lower premolar with the canine. We want to give the canine guidance, both lower canine and premolar. And we want to maintain an adequate interpremolar width. And so this is the approach that we have in this case with the agenesia or extraction of a lower incisors. So this is what we did. Now we have a beautiful class one this side, and here we have a class three because here there is the canine, but we want to distalize more and more in order to have in this side a beautiful class one with the premolar. So we engage the canine as the canine it was an incisors, but this is a canine. Then we connect the arch with the straight wire, and then we reach the beautiful class one here with the premolars. And here we have, as you can see, class three. This is when we finish. And we maintain in the right side the wisdom teeth, okay, in order to have more support in the lower arch where we have the class three, okay? And we extract the upper wisdom teeth, because it was out of the occlusion. Now we centered the midline, obviously, with the lateral and the central incisors. Look the correction of the overjet that we have. We have a very good protrusion of the lower incisors. We maintain this, and this is the distalization that we have on one side, the distalization that we have on the other side in the upper arch. And this is after 1 year, 4 months. This is before and after. Before and after, look the midline with the central incisors, the class three here, and the class one the other side. Before and after, And here you can see the sequence. Okay. So this is the canine. This is the premolar. We have the beautiful class one with the premolar. And this is the canine. And this is another treatment. I was wrong before. Okay, this is a class one, and in this side we are a class three. Then we connect the arch and look the reduction of overjet that we have with this correction and the relationship between the teeth. That are a beautiful relationship, and we think that it's very, very stable. So we are really on time because we have the last patient, that is Maria. And I love this case because it's very, very difficult, very, very difficult. And she's open bite, very, very big overjet, cross bite here on the premolar. And she has pain and click on the right side of the joint. And she hasn't crowding, but she was treated by another orthodontist. And he just complained about the lower incisor. In fact, he put something here in order to maintain straight these lower incisors, but he didn't see the malocclusion that this patient has. He didn't see the profile. He didn't see the strain that she has when she closed the lips, the lip incompetency. Incredible. He finished the case in this way. Here we have a big cyst. Okay. And I sent to my mentor, to Professor Torres, in order to remove this teeth and the cyst here, to remove the other wisdom teeth. Okay. We check the joint, we have a compression and distalization of the joint in this case. And we have an asymmetry. Look at the different shape of the ramus of the mandible in the right side and the left side. If you compare, you can see the amount of asymmetry that this patient has. And in the posterior cephalogram, it's evident the asymmetry that this patient has. Incredible. The amount of the midline deviation, the asymmetry of the mandible, the compression of the condyle, and the compression of the ramus. Obviously, she is dolichofacial, 83 of fascial axis, high convexity, double protrusion. Okay, this is a very difficult case. And she said, the patient said, I don't want surgery. Don't ask me any kind of surgery. I said, really, it's impossible without surgery. Let me say that I want to do, because you have this amount of the fasciolate. This fasciolate is too high for to obtain the competency with the lip. So I want to perform, when I finish with the orthodontics, I want to perform just genioplasty here, in order to improve your chin and your competency. And with this golden divider, invented by Ricketts, I show that point A should be here. I said it's here. Mm-hmm. And though she complained for symmetry, convex profile, labial incompetency, and she said no surgery. She has a cyst in the wisdom teeth, impacted the other wisdom teeth, upper distal displacement in both joints, maxillary symmetry, mandibular symmetry, class 2 on the right, full class 2 on the left, and the open mouth. She's very difficult case. And this is the plan, okay? The computer suggests to me extraction, four extraction for this case, plus the wisdom teeth means 8 extraction. So it's a grade 2 of extraction. So it's a lot of dental support that I must remove to obtain an improvement of the profile, of the function of this patient. And so I imagine in this case to correct the asymmetry, saving one premolar. So extract the wisdom teeth plus just 3 premolars. I don't want to extract the lower left premolar in order to correct the asymmetry, in order to obtain, obviously, a camouflage in this particular case. And the other reason was because I had a good position of the lower incisor. So I don't want to move backward the lower incisors. And the genioplasty. Here you can see the genioplasty that I planned at that time. 8 millimeter up and 2 millimeter forward, okay? In order to obtain the golden proportion in the beautiful profile in this case. Mm. So for this reason, I put Maria here, very in the left side of the curve, and it's an extreme case, and I want to obtain a camouflage. So I start 1 year later when she removed the cyst. Mm. And so I extract the premolars, again the anchorage in the upper arch with the quadilix, and I start to move back the canine just in the right side. I save the premolar on the left side. Then look the spontaneous correction of the midline due to the extraction, to the asymmetrical extraction. Then I use the push and pull arch. I push from the left side to the right side, and now I have I obtained the midline correction. So, and I didn't put any brackets in the upper arch in this moment because I don't need. Okay, it's simple. I put bracket where I need in this. Phase. So this is a standard class 2 correction with the sectional mechanics, but you must to individualize the mechanics in order to obtain this kind of result. Then I want now to correct the torque to move the upper denture backward with the light intruder retractor. I still without brackets here in the left side. Then one day, Maria came to me and said, oh, now I find the husband. So you must remove the appliances because I get married. So I don't want the appliances anymore. I said, no, wait, we must do the genioplasty. I want to finish this case. I love this case. So I want to finish very, very good. I didn't like the position of this canine at that time. And so he said, no, 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 no. So I removed the appliances, but I want to check. And now he said, oh, you look better, incredible. Look the self, Sergio, it's nice. So I put my golden divider and I said, oh, incredible. Now I have the golden proportion without any surgery. Oh, it's incredible. Let's superimpose with my plan and what's the same. Okay, I superimpose and you can see that if you superimpose here on the aesthetic line, the result is the same. I said, oh, without any surgery. And she's 26. Incredible. Beautiful response. Oh, look the posterior anterior. Now it's symmetrical. Incredible. Incredible. So the biologic approach reserved to you really very, very nice results. Very nice surprise. This is biology. This is long treatments, four years. But she's nice. She looks nice, really nice. She's after 2 years. No. This is a before and after. Look, you don't need the safe to see that the profile improve a lot. This is a before and after. Before and after. And if you superimpose, look the modification of the mandible in this side, the adaptation of the mandible, incredible, that we have with this kind of approach in an adult patient, before and after. Before and after, look the strain. Here there is no strain. Before and after, before and after. This is the sequence. Look the midline problem here. Then with the asymmetrical extraction. Correction. And when we finish. Very nice. So look, the mandible went forward. This is the correction in the upper arch. This is the correction in the lower arch. I'm very proud of this case. This is after 1 year and 4 months. Sorry. This is after 6 years and 9 months. So after 6 years and 9 months, it's a very, very stable, very, very stable case. I'm very, very happy with this kind of result. Okay, so we finish and we are on time for dinner. Oh, someone insert another case. So I ask to you, Akram, if I can present this case or...
That would be fine. That would be fine.
Okay. So this is Monica. This is a very, very old case. And I call Monica a demon case. You know, in the brochure, demon brochure, you'll see this canine up here. They put the magic wire, the demon magic wire, and they fix everything. For this reason, I call a demon case. She has a very, very severe crowding, a severe crowding, 7.6 millimeters of crowding in the lower arch, but she is a dolico fascia. She is 80 degree of fascial axis, high convexity, but she has a nice profile. So she has a big nose. So we don't want to modify this this profile. So she has ectopic upper canines misalignment in the upper arch. She is a class 2 deep bite dolichofacial high convex. And we want to treat her even if it's a dolichofacial without extraction. So we want to expand both up and lower arch. And this is what we did. We put Monica here. Mm-hmm. And we do this, we apply with the, we start with the Quadilix in the upper arch and with the Bilix in the lower arch. Then we start with the bioprogressive approach. We open the bite with utility arch, we distalize with sections, then we reconnect with the delta, and then we finish. Very easy. We don't like this position of the canine, but we have a beautiful class one in the upper, so we must wait for the position of this canine for the growth. Look the very, very nice shape of the arches that we obtain. Very nice and close to the Ricketts value. This is after the treatment. After the treatment, a very, very good position of the teeth after the correction. We maintain the position of the lower incisors to the dental plane that is very, very difficult. So we correct the crowding with the Bielix. And this is the superimposition of the VTO in the result that we had, that it's a very, very nice result. Mm. This is after 1 year and 6 months. This is after 5 years and and 2 months. Look, the improvement of the position of the canine and the occlusion that is stable during the years. This is before and after, and this is 10 years and 8 months after treatment. Very, very stable case, very nice case. Very nice profile that she has, okay? She didn't seem dolichofacial patient. She has a big nose, but with this kind of approach, we have a beautiful emplacement of the denture and a beautiful, beautiful smile. This is after the treatment, after 1 year, 6 months, after 5 years, 2 months, and after 10 years and 8 months. Very beautiful result, very nice. Okay, now we finish really. Let's go to conclusion. You saw this patient, and we obtained very, very nice smiles to this patient, and we love this job and this kind of approach that to me it's very biological. And the main part of the treatment is the diagnosis, as Carl Cugino stated many years ago. The 75% of the correction of the malocclusion depends on the diagnosis. Then 10% of unlocking and just the 5% of mechanics. So if you focus on mechanics, it's just the 5%. And in order to achieve simplicity, you must prevent the worsening of the condition and individualize the treatment. The take home message is the sophisticated diagnosis allows an effective, efficient, aesthetic, and biologic approach. The mechanisms that make things simple are sometimes very complex. The simplistic approach is candidate to failure to solve difficult problems. And the 360 degrees rehabilitation of the dental patient is the role of the true specialist. And I want to finish with this definition of orthodontist by Ricketts. No, sorry. I have a problem here with the... Sorry. Okay. Orthodontics may seem small, and in the total scheme of things, it may appear insignificant, but we perform a unique function to mankind. We contribute to his comfort, to his happiness, and to his sense of well-being. We touch the very heart of modern culture. Man is a gregarious animal. He clusters together for security, and he groups for stimulation with his fellows. His face, his mouth, and his teeth help him to relate and communicate with the other, and more importantly, to establish his identity. This, in turn, leads to happiness, love, and to a sense of accomplishment and purpose. This is the definition of orthodontics by Ricketts, and I love this definition. And I want to say thank you to the students that stimulate me, and the chairman of the Insubria University where I teach, Professor Capeoglio, that gave to me this great opportunity at the University of Insubria. And to Professor Marco Cicciu with this team, Dr. Professor Cervino and Dr. Fiorillo, that gave to me the possibility to work with them and to publish many papers in the orthodontic and the prosthetic field. I also want to say thank you to my staff that they always help to me in to the work to present my cases, and particularly Loredana, Nicola, Giovanna, Emanuela, Roberta, Massimo, Thea, Melania, Marco, Salvo, and Chiara, that I don't know why I miss his photo, unfortunately. And I want to say this is greetings from here, from Sicily, from my family, Elisa, my wife, Alessandro, and Giulia, my little daughter. I want to dedicate this presentation in memory of all the people that passed away for COVID. And now we have the freedom. So this in Italian means freedom. And you can join me in Facebook on in my web page for courses, seminar, or lecture. If you want to ask questions, email me, send case, everything here. This is my mail, this is my page, this is my Facebook. Thank you very much for your kind attention. I hope that you like the presentation.